سبحانه وتعالى give me a good health, I will celebrate the Mawlud. Because ليس مشروع, it is not established. Right? Or if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he give me this, I will, you know, do something that is not established in the religion. So it has to be within the realms of the religion. It has to be from the ibadat that has been established, that has been laid out, that has been barakallahu fikum, yani legislated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. So therefore, if the individual now, he does it, he have this vow, so he is making it binding upon himself now. Not the Sharia made it binding upon him, but he is making it binding upon himself. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala he mentioned, ثُمَّ لِيَقُضُوا نَفَثَهُمْ. And after that they completed the Hajj. طيب. And after that they completed the Hajj. طيب. وَلْيُوفُوا نُذُورَهُمْ. And they will do what? They will fulfill their vows. After they completed their Hajj, they will do what? وَلْيُوفُوا نُذُورَهُمْ. They will fulfill their vows. وَلْيُطَوَّفْ بِالْبَيْتِ الْعَطِيقِ. And they will do, بَارَكَ اللَّهُ فِيكُمْ, this tawaf, which is the tawaf al-ifada. Which is the tawaf al-ifada. طيب. What is to be done after the tawaf al-ifada? What are the acts of worship that a person will do after the tawaf al-ifada? What are the actions that you do after the act of after the tawaf al-ifada? Name one or two. Tawaf al-ifada, tawaf al-ifada, the tawaf. Yes. No. What is it from those Hajj rituals that you do after the tawaf al-ifada? After the person yani completes the tawaf al-ifada, what does he do? Maqam Ibrahim. What else? What else? Yes, shaving the head. What else? And barakallahu fikum, slaughtering the hadi. This is all of it to be done after the tawaf al-ifada. So the Shah rahimahullah, he mentioned here in this verse, he say, وَلْيَطَوَّفُوا بِالْبَيْتِ الْعَطِيقِ. And to be making the yani that which is the tawaf al-ifada here, right? Meaning to circumambulate the Kaaba. But here, barakallahu fikum, what is meant in this circumambulation is the tawaf al-ifada. As when you go to the books of tafsir, this is barakallahu fikum here. وَلْيُطَوَّفُوا بِالْبَيْتِ الْعَطِيقِ بِمَعْنَى تَوَافُ الْإِفَادَ. This is what is intended in this statement. والنظر and the vow الذي هو, as Sheikh Fawzan Hafidha also explained to us what is the meaning of vowing. Sheikh Uthaymeen Rahimahullah, he said the same thing. He said vowing is that the person, he is binding upon himself something that was not binding upon him, whether it is a matter of a ta'a for Allah that is غَيْرُ wajibun. That is not an obligation upon him. And likewise, it is not makruh. It is not wajib, but he is binding upon him. And it is not makruh. It is not dislike. So he is binding upon himself an act of worship that is not wajib upon him. Right? What is wajib? What fasting is wajib upon us? Ramadan. Fasting the month of Ramadan. So if he say, I'm vowed to fast 3 days. So yep, when I have this fasting is not wajib. Right? And the second thing is that it is also not makruh. It is not something that is dislike. So they have to have this. It is not something that is, it is something that is not wajib. Meaning that action was not wajib. And it is not barakallahu fikum makruh needs at the same time. Meaning something that is dislike in the religion, a person cannot make it a vow of it. So likewise, if it is something that is haram, min bab al-awla. طيب. وقال بعض العلماء, and some of the scholars they mention, إنه, that vowing, it is something that is haram, muharramun. Some of the scholars, they say vowing is haram. Why did I say this? Because of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam naha anin nadhar. Because the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he has indeed prohibited from vowing. Right? And what is the qa'ida? The qa'ida in regard to yani prohibiting something. If there is a prohibition that shows what it is, it is not permissible. Right? They shows that the tahrim of a matter, if something is being prohibited, it shows that it is not permissible. طيب? If something is prohibited, it shows that it is not permissible. So this is why some of the scholars, they mentioned that it is haram to be vowing. طيب? Based on the statement of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he mentioned innahu la yati bi khairin, then nothing good comes out of it. Wa innama yastakhriju bihi min al-bakhil, it is only a way to extract something from somebody that is a tight-fisted one, someone that is miser, right? It is only a way to extract something from someone that is a miser person. So he mentioned, إِنَّهُ لَا يَأْتِ بِخَيْرٍ إِنَّهُ لَا يَأْتِ بِخَيْرٍ, is nothing good comes out of it. He said, وَإِنَّمَا يَسْتَخْرِجُ بِهِ, it is only a way trying to cause a miser person to do action. That would be the only reason why this individual will, you know, the miser person will do action. طيب. And as this hadith that is authenticated, brought by Imam al-Bukhari, رحمه تبارك وتعالى. ومع ذلك, and with all of this, فإذا نذر الإنسان, so now we understand this, that it is not good to be making vows. That's what we first understand from this. It is not good to be making vows. But فإذا نذر الإنسان, now if the person now fall into making a vow, it is not good to make a vow. But if the person, فَإِذَا نَذَرَ الْإِنسَانِ تَاعَةً لِلَّهِ, if the person, عَلَيْكُمْ سَلَمْ, he make a vow to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَجَبَ عَلَيْهِ, now it becomes an obligation for him. Now it becomes an obligation for him to do what? To establish that action. فِعْلُهَا, for that action. لقول صلى الله عليه وسلم, based on the statement of the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, من نذر, whoever vow, أن يطيع الله, to obey Allah, فليطيعه, let him do what? Let him obey Allah. So here we have these two hadith, طيب, that could sound like a contradiction in on. One, he mentioned إنه لا يأتي بخير, that there is nothing good that comes out of it. Right? And he mentioned to the hadith, وَإِنَّمَا يَسْتَخْرِجُ بِهِ مِنَ الْبَخِيلِ, it is only a way to cause a person that is miser to be doing acts of worship. And the other narration that we just see, he say, whoever مَنْ نَذَرَ, whoever made a vow, أَنْ يُتِيعَ اللَّهَ, to obey Allah, فَلْيُتِيعْهُ, let him obey him. So this is now, we got to bring these two hadith together. Right? Bringing it together, so there will be no contradiction in our mind no more, in our heads no more. How do we bring it together? Sheikh Uthaymeen mentioned here that it is not good to make a vow. But if the individual make a vow, he has to do what? He has to fulfill it. But now we know. So it is not for the person to be making no vow. طيب. And a lot of time, the individual that makes a vow about a matter, he say, I vow to do this. If you look at it, he was not doing those actions. Or he was not very knee on those actions. So what barakallahu fikum the messenger mentioned, وَإِنَّمَا يَسْتَخْرِجُ بِهِ مِنَ الْبَخِيلِ, that this individual, well, prior to this, was not doing it. So he say, if Allah give me this, I will fast 3 days. If you look at this person really, he will not be fasting 3 days out of the month. Or if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala able with this, I will give sadaqah. If you look at this individual, he was not somebody that was easy at giving sadaqah. So he will look at that which was very difficult for him, and he will think that this is a great thing for him to do. Right? So now he will vow and then want to make their actions. That's why the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned, وَإِنَّمَا يَسْتَخْرِجُ بِهِ مِنَ الْبَخِيلِ. That it is only that which will cause a miser person to be doing some actions. And this is, alhamdulillah, what completed the issue that we wanted to mention in regard to the another. Yes, Yusuf. Oh, I don't have the English. Huh? Alhamdulillah. So we mentioned that the two, number one is what? Number one is that the conditions you have to, the nadhar has to be, it has to be act of worship, number two. It has to be act of worship, number two. Huh? You have to have the ability to fulfill it, number three. You have to have the ownership of what you, barakallah, if you're going to make a vow. Huh? Right, it has to be, meaning it has to be, no, the vow has to be, barakallah, fikum, an act of obedience. It has to be an act of obedience now. What's that? Where can you find it? I'll show you the book. Yes. Some people say a'udhu. Is it correct? A'udhu billah. Well, it can be correct because when you say a'udhu billah, whatever that you are seeking refuge, you listening? Whatever you're seeking refuge in it, this is completing it. It's just like when you say Bismillah and you drink, right? So the fact that you're drinking is completing your sentence. So it's correct. He praised those who fulfilled it. Now here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he praised the fulfillment of the nadhar. Shuf. He praised the fulfillment of the nadhar. Yufuna bin nadhar. He didn't praise the nadhar, but he praised what? The fulfillment of the nadhar. Right? And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Shaykh Uthaymeen rahimah, he said, Naha anin an-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Naha anin nadhar. When he mentioned, Innahu la yati bi khayrin. And it is no good that is coming out of it. وَإِنَّمَا يَسْتَخْرِجُ بِهِ مِنَ الْبَخِيلِ. It is only a way that can cause a miser person to do something. Right? So therefore, this is, alhamdulillah, how do we understand it, right? Sometimes two hadith will come and it will be a little bit problematic. But when we listen to how the scholars, they understand it, it will be very easy. Right? Like the hadith, the three hadiths or two hadiths we discussed this today. Right? About the hadith of? Huh? Ibn Umar. And the hadith of? And Abu Huraira. Right? How do we understand those two hadith? Abu Ahmed?
Yeah. The first one, he said,
who said that? Now he said that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِذَا صَلَّى أَحَدُكُمُ الْجُمْعَةِ فَلْيُصَلِّي بَعْدَهَا أَرْبَعًا. So here it is what? Amr, important. So the hadith of Abu Huraira was a command. Very good, okay.
The other one is two raka
in man. Hadith man. Ibn Umar, yes. So he say that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam la yusalli ba'da al-jum'ah hatta yansarif fi baytihi wa salla fihi raka'atayn. The Prophet will not pray anything after Jum'ah except after he leaves to his home and then he will pray two raka'ah.
So it's good to make just four and then other two, we can agree, it's no problem. I will have to do that.
Okay, he said.